start in the first room, which is right here. And this is going to be our main artwork, which is a cross. It was burned in Sarah Patton Boyd's yard by the KKK. This was done because she was a civil rights activist and she was fighting for her rights. And the white supremacists were disgusted by this and burned it in her yard. And it's very powerful artwork. And she donated this to the UVA library, and we would like to see it in the museum as a center of her piece. As soon as you walk in, you'll see that. And we have a plaque describing her story. And to the next room, Ashley.
So the next room, we're going to have like a glass case and probably a model, maybe a 3D model or something, of Jefferson's early idea of the wanted grounds of the original UVA campus. So along the east side, we would have put these all the pavilions, and those are where the professors originally lived. And right here, those are the gardens. So we wanted to really break it down and label like where the space had an impact in this structure, because this is like the presentation said, like Jefferson sketched everything with purpose. So basically the slaves would use corridors and live under the residences of the professors. They wanted similar to Monticello, they wanted them sort of like unseen and just quietly working, I guess. And they would do a lot of their work in these gardens, like the cooking and cleaning and like all the behind the scenes work for residents and students in the UVA. And so basically, like they said before, the circumcision walls, they were meant basically, it encloses them, and they were really high. So basically it's this unseen labor workforce that was completely segregated. Like you have buildings right here on one side, and the buildings here at the Middle Village, where you have the slave enclosed in this little like rectangle box. So we really want to emphasize the architecture of that and like what it meant back then. So next in these glass cases, we went to the Special Collections Library and looked at documents from like the early civil rights period. So I was just gonna pick out a few of them in here. So this one is called I Was Told South Won't Mix Schools. So author quotes, large sections of the South provide a racially mixed schools under any circumstances for the foreseeable future. And falls with the implication here is Trump will keep up this fight. It is quite probable that the Supreme Court will modify its decision. So this is some examples of like Charlottesville residents fighting against integration in local schools. So this is just an excerpt from a newspaper that demonstrates that Charlottesville fighting against desegregation. So areas of Charlottesville sent a case to the Court of Appeals, but then you can't read it, obviously. But it says the court upheld the Oregon Supreme Court concerning the integration law. So yeah, and then the next one, integration at Lane, and we'll find out about this. So Lane is a local high school that we learned about. It's near Vinegar Hill, which is like 10 minutes from here, I guess. And so it was basically a white high school. And so when they started integrating it, caused a lot of like unrest among residents. So of course there's always news about it, but luckily this was carried out without any incidents. So, and then this is titled Washington Crime Figures by Race Are Listed. So basically this is a list of like crime, assault, disease, rape statistics that like apparently happened in an area that was integrated. So the author is trying to like plant this notion in people's minds that integration will cause all of these bad events. And it also follows with, do we want to leave these facts before us that white parents do not wish their children to attend integrated schools? So just some of the back and forth arguments. intellectual awakening and how we sort of like preserve this heritage of English Saxon boy. So yeah, we're just gonna have the artifacts in these cases with descriptions about them. So in the next room, Sophie's room.
So in the second room, we're gonna have other African Americans that were forced to come to the VA and impact the school. So this is Alice Jackson. In 1935, she tried to apply to the VA, and instead of like letting her come to the school, they gave her to Columbia. And this is Bertram Swanson. In 1950, he was the first African American to ever come to the VA. And he was a law student at UVA. And he left in 1951 because of all the racism and the pressure he had at the UVA. And this is Walter Berkeley. He was the second African American to come to UVA. And he was also the first to graduate in 1953. And this is Roy Willis. So he was admitted to UVA in 1959 as an art and science student. He was also the first African American to ever live in Milan in room 43. And he graduated in 1962. And this is Sandra Lewis. She was the first female African American student to come here. And she graduated in 1972, and her daughter shortly followed after. And the next room we got the Hall of Fame.
Alright, so this is the African American Alumni Hall of Fame for UVA. And in this room we're gonna have 10 busts of like notable alumni who took on the challenge to go to UVA, even though it was a very white school, so it was a very challenging, and they had to stick with it, and they broke barriers that not many other people could do. So we just wanted to commemorate them. And this is the first one, Leroy Roundtree Hassel. He was a justice for the Supreme Court, and he ended up being the first African-American Chief Justice for the Virginia Supreme Court, serving 2 4-year terms from February 1st, 2003 to January 31st, 2001. And these are brothers Tiki and Rondé Barber. They both play football at UVA, and they both ended up making it to the NFL. Tiki Barber was a running back for the New York Giants for 10 seasons. He had over 10,000 rushing yards and 55 touchdowns, which is pretty good numbers. And then Rondé Barber, a future Hall of Famer, played 16 seasons, and he had over 1,200 tackles, 47 interceptions, and 22 fumbles. This is the British Alberson, another football player that broke barriers and stuck with the UVA school. And he played 10 seasons for the New York Jets. That's one of the best backs. He was 7'4". He was a phenom in the 1983 draft. He was the number one overall pick, and he went to the Houston Rockets. He had over 752 blocks, 4,011 total rebounds, and 7,039 total points. So he was a big player. And this is Sasha Zamata. You might have seen her on Saturday Night Live. And she debuted January 18, 2014. This is Dawn Staley, one of the most outstanding women basketball players to ever play. She is now a coach for NC State. She was a three-time Olympian and was elected to carry out the flag at the 2016 Olympics. This is Boyd Tinsley. He's an American violinist and mandolinist who performs as a member of the Dave Matthews Band. John Charles Thomas. He was the first African American on the Virginia Supreme Court and the youngest of any color to be on the Supreme Court. And the last one was a pretty amazing story. He started at the University of Richmond, and then he came to UVA to get his degree in engineering. He served on the space shuttle for Atlantis as a mission specialist. And in the middle of our room, we wanted to, this big part right here is gonna be for the Givens, William and Isabella Givens, who sought on the challenge of learning to read and write while being in slavery. So we wanted to commemorate them as they were, if you saw the statue at the Madison's house of James Madison and his wife, we kind of want to do that with Isabella and William and just give them a nice that's why we're using it.